verse 23. Someone would like to read that verse for us this morning, Hebrews 10, 23.
Let us hold fast to the profession of our faith without wavering. He is faithful and just.
Amen. If there were ever a time to hold fast our faith, I mean, it's always been, but especially today, as our faith as Christians, even here in America, they're not dragging us out of churches. They're not banning and burning Bibles. But guess what? We are being persecuted here in this country, even in America today. Seems like anytime you mention the name Jesus, somebody has a problem with it, right? Folks can do this, do that, but a coach, remember that coach we prayed for in Georgia last year? Just praying for his kids before a baseball game. Some people got upset with it. Guess what? And the kids were leading the prayer. It wasn't the coach. The kids on the baseball team wanted to have prayer before they went out there to play. But they got mad at what? The coach. Wanted to fire the what? The coach. The coach said, I'm not going to change who I am. The coach said, yeah, I'm a Christian. I'm not going to do that. These young men want to pray. He applauds that. But the school system and those in power had what? A problem with it. Some of them didn't have kids on the team, but they were upset about it. Why? Because the name of Jesus. Yeah. You know, people can do any and everything. Everything else is all right. Well, let's do it this way. But when you put Jesus in it, oh, no. The world immediately has a problem. I think as my son stated on Tuesday, it's kind of funny, Ryan, right? Like whenever you mention Jesus, that's when folks have a problem with it, right? I mean, you can say something, anything else, but boy, you get Jesus in it. Mm-mm. You can even say Christian sometimes, but now Jesus. You know, I'm following Jesus. A lot of folks name the name Jesus. Call themselves Christian, attend church, put money in the plate, they're benchmen. They ain't on the team. They know Jesus, but the question is, does he know you? Is your name written, as the scripture says, in the Lamb's Book of Life? Muslims know Jesus. A lot of people know about the historical Jesus. A lot of faith, Buddhism, they'll tell, oh yeah, we believe Jesus lived, but he was just a good prophet. Oh, no. He was a good teacher. No, he was more than that. He was the Son of God. That's what we believe. That's what separates us and our faith from all other people. Not going to really argue with you if they have any kind of sin. A Muslim won't argue against you saying Jesus wasn't here. There are too many documents to prove that. So they know he lived, but he wasn't who he said he was. And now he really didn't die. He skated off. He what? Come on out there. That's why he wasn't in the tomb, because he got it. Come on, man. So they won't deny the fact that he was here, but they don't want to acknowledge the fact that he's who he said he was. So let us hold fast to profession of what? Our faith. Without wavering, I can't shake it. Like I said, I told y'all, and I'll tell you again, they'll come and arrest me and lock me up before they make me do anything contrary to the word of God. And I said this before, the scripture holds true. These principles outweigh the principles in the world. If the world says it's okay now for me to go out there and do something, they say, hey, y'all remember that movie, The Purge? Anybody seen that movie, The Purge? If the world says it's okay, brother, I'll go out there and kill whoever you want to kill. No, scripture still says, I ain't supposed to be going out there killing for. Well, the world says, okay, you got one day, man, don't let your hair down, just do it. I don't think so. So when that law goes against this law, this is my ultimate test. Now when it tells me to do 35 out there, ain't nothing wrong with that. The Bible doesn't say, thou shalt speed, right? The Bible doesn't say, thou shalt, as my man said, ride dirty around nation. If the Bible doesn't say it, and these laws don't contradict this, I can do what they say, right? I can do that. But when that goes against this, my God is right here. So we want to hold fast to our faith, and we can't wait. Hey, now more than ever. Our next election again, find us faithful. I think this one is going to sing. They'll sing for us, so we can just listen. They're going to bless us with song. little line that song says, "Find us faithful." Those who come in generations after we're gone said, "Man, those believed in 2015, they still will hold the truth," right? That they find us faithful. That we didn't water it down and we didn't run and hide. We didn't throw our hands and say, "Oh, Jesus, today, today," and go hide. And they find us. I pray to God they would find us what? The church in 2015? They would find us faithful. This morning, of course, now time for our preached word. Two passages from Scripture. We'll be going back to the book of 2 Kings. We're looking at the first half of this chapter. And then we'll go to the New Testament, and look at Luke chapter 4, verses 27 through 30. So we'll go back to 2 Kings chapter 5, if you read a portion of that for our Old Testament scripture reading this morning. And then we'll finish up with Luke 4, 27 through 30.
Seven times in the Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God,
And his flesh came again, like unto the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. Wow. So he was obedient. He didn't do it his way. He did it God's way, and things worked out right for him. Luke chapter 40, verse 27. This is Christ speaking. My Bible, this is read. This indicates Jesus speaking. And Jesus says in Luke 4, 27, and many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha, the prophet, and none of them was cleansed, saving Naaman the Syrian. What we just read, Jesus is referencing him. And then he says, and all they in the synagogue, though, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. They got mad and rose up and thrust him out of the city. Get out of here, Jesus. And led him unto the brow of the hill whereon their city was built, that they might cast him down headlong. They were going to throw Jesus from the cliff. But he, Jesus, passing through the midst of them, went his way. He went his way. Now, the past couple of Sundays, refresh your memory really quick. A couple of Sundays ago, we spoke about knowing the way, right? And of course, the way being who? Jesus. Last week, we talked about knowing the times. When the scripture said, go look at the stork, look at the crane. The stork knows when it's time to take off and leave. He realizes cold times are coming. That bird has enough sense to know it's time for me to get up. But we, as human beings, act like we don't know what time it is, right? Like the Bible said, as in the days of Noah, right up until Noah left here, people still doing what they want to do, living it up, having a good old time. Noah's preaching, y'all need to get right. Come on now, y'all see me building this thing, it's going to rain. What's rain? We never heard that before. Noah said, get it right. The world's still doing what they want to do. But the birds, man, we have, the scripture said the ants even have enough sense to know to put away for lean time. So we talked about knowing the times and knowing the way. This morning, for just a few minutes, we're going to talk about my way. Okay, and when you see that little kid right there, what do you think is happening right there? Anybody that's a parent, hello, been to the grocery store? Anybody ever go to Toys R Us besides me? When you really ain't meaning to buy nothing, you really shouldn't have went in there. You ain't got no money for Joffrey, none of them, no way. But somebody done seen something they want. Yeah. And they want it. They walk around dragging an Elmo. Here comes G.I. Joe. I want a Hot Wheel. Daddy, get me a Transformer. Daddy ain't meant to buy nothing. Daddy trying to get mama a brain on. Daddy trying to kill time. I said, come on, kid. Let's take them doing some window shopping. Kids don't understand window shopping. They say, well, Daddy, we done come inside the window. Ain't we supposed to leave with something? I know I said that. Ain't we supposed to leave with something, Daddy? But you're walking up and down these aisles and somebody has a nerve to say, but I want the And you see that little joke right there, you're going to take your hand and bless him. In the name, you want to lay some hands that may not be too holy on him or her. Yeah. But you know they got cameras in these stores now. Come on now. Right. And you know everybody and their mom got one of these. And boy, as soon as you get to acting a fool in there, what they going to yell out? Well, they're going to put you on blast. But sometimes that little joke stand there and say, I want to do that. You say, well, Jimmy, your birthday, I will come back. Nah, I want it now. Jimmy wants it what? He wants it his way. He don't want to listen to you and say, well, you got to do this. And Jimmy, let's bring, let's clean your room up. Let's do something else. And maybe we'll come back and get the little joke. Now, Jimmy, they want it what? Right now. They want it their way. And you know what? Some of us, I'm 45 years old. Some of us, my age and older, still act just like this on the inside. Especially when it comes to the things of God. God said, Robert, I need you to do it like this. Well, no, I want to add a little sizzle to it. You know, I want to do this to it. I know what you said, but can we add this and do all this? Like, no, Robert, this is what I need you to do. Read my word, son. You can read. You got glasses on, boy. Can't you read what it say? Just do what this is enough in itself. We want to add something to it. Why? Because I want to do it my way. Anybody in the world besides me ever heard this before? My way or no way? Somebody, amen. Somebody bad enough to say, I said it. I remember living in my mother's house. It was mama's way. It wasn't no way at all. Yeah. Mama said this is the way it was. I couldn't say it with my friend. Hello, y'all. My best friend in the world. Yeah, right here. That man right there. You know, I could say, well, mama's love. Mama said, nah, but you ain't you know, you my son. You know, and it don't matter what they doing out there in no cliff. You here with me. You there. Well, he going to the park. I want an hour. And my friend would get to go. We go to the park. But I had to leave at a certain time, you know. Mama come and pick me up, and don't let her blow more than once when she.
Oh,
matter of fact, I just really wanted to blow. They were kind of embarrassed. They would see me looking out the window. Okay, yeah, let me go, you know, give me a little drink. I walk by the door, and all of a sudden, Robert, where are you going? Oh, man, I had to leave. Ain't nobody got to know my mama out there. Ain't nobody got to know I had to leave for the party. It was just time to go. Mama said, son, if you don't go, it's my way, or you won't go at all. So she said, son, you can go and maybe spend a couple, 3 hours there, but Sunday, you got to be at church. You got to be at Sunday school. And you can't get there half asleep because I let you go out on Saturday night with your little friend. No, you got to come home at a certain time. So I heard this as well, Sister Smith. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was my way or it was no way at all. So we live in a society today where people feel like it's their way or no way. There's no room for anything else. Then unfortunately, we go on to folks who come back to the, it's got to be my way. You know, normally this is like a one-way sign. You know, when the scripture teaches there's one way to glory, but now people come and say, well, no, you can do this and, well, you can have Jesus and, no, ain't no Jesus. Little song we used to sing says, I got Jesus and that's enough. I don't need Jesus and Buddha or Jesus and this or Jesus and no prayer cloud, Jesus and no oil, Jesus and no this. All I need is Jesus. That's enough for me. In the scripture on this one, here's a man, I don't know how old he was, but he had to be a man of a decent set of age because he was a military leader. Going out, taking over people, he had took some people from Israel captive and had this little Israelite maiden here in the house. And Naaman has a disease called leprosy. It made him unclean, sores and all this kind of other, and all this, it wasn't nice to be around. But he was doing a good job. He was saying that the Lord helped him. Go back and look at the scripture. It says that the Lord, verse 1, had given deliverance unto Syria. See, it says he was honorable. It says because of him, the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria. God was going to use his name. So it says, sir, he had all these wonderful things, but he was a leper. And the Syrians had gone out by companies and brought away captives. So they had some Israelite people here. Captain, one of them was this little maid girl. We don't even know the woman's name. But guess what? Even in captivity, she knew where her hope. We just talked about a song right there. Talking about our faith, right? And our faith remaining steadfast. This little woman here had faith and had hope in the fact that she was a maid for somebody, but she still knew the power of her God and the prophets where she come from.
Right.
In so much, you say, your husband sure look bad. All them sores and stuff on. Man, if you back where I come from, prophet sure could deal with that. She knew that where she come from, they dealt with stuff like that. Go back and look at Leviticus 14 sometime if you want to. And talk and listen, look at the procedure for cleansing of a leprous person. God had ways to deal with that kind of stuff. Everybody that had leprosy wasn't meant to die with it. That's why there was a ceremonial type cleaning and thing that had to go on with it. Some folks got cured of their leprosy. But they had to do it what? God's way. It wasn't no my way to it. They had to do it according to what? What thus said the Lord. There were so many days they had to do this, and on the seventh day you do this. And man, guess what? And y'all laughing. You know, I'm growing my hair a little bit up here. You know, my wife told me pretty soon I had to cut it off. That's a agreement we made 20-something years ago when we got married. I said, well, baby, I'll cut my hair. I should have said it. I said, I'll cut my hair any way you want to, as long as you don't cut yours. And Miss Becky, she's held me to that for 22 years. Which is that, Robert, it's getting too long. I think it's time you go get a haircut. But I'm, but it's to your hair. Yeah.
That's a natural haircut.
Yeah, that's what I think. But anyway, she gave me a little time to grow this thing up. She already let me know it's coming off. She says it's coming. You know, it's got to go one day. But when these folks here went through this cleansing for leprosy, they had to shave off all their hair machine. And not just the hair on their head, they had to shave off their eyebrows and everything. I mean, they look like a cartoon, like a Muppet. You ever seen a Muppet on Sesame Street? When they take the eyebrows up off of them, they look kind of weird looking. That's what they look like. I mean, imagine your face, you do like this, and ain't nothing up there. Eyebrows gone. All this gone. They had to shave off everything. This is part of this cleansing they had to go through. So this is part of what Leviticus 14 says. So this man being a leprous man, this maiden says, man said, would to God my Lord, this is a saying from where she comes and said, would to God my Lord were with the prophet that is in Samaria. For he would recover him, he would heal him of his leprosy. But he'd have to do it according to what said the Lord. So somebody heard that, and they believed this little girl. Now this little girl in captivity, being turned from whatever she was into a maid, now she's having to wait on somebody else. She still has her faith and trust in God's word. So much so that she obviously had to what? Walk that thing out in captivity. We're praying for brother or pastor Saeed Abedini, right? Remember in many of the news stories you read about him, how he prayed for those guards over in Iran after they whipped and beat him, caused the man some internal bleeding, but they wouldn't even touch him because they said, you're a Christian, we're Muslim, we can't even come over and give you medical help because we'd be considered unclean, fooling with you. But their hands were sure enough, clean enough to beat on the man. And after they beat on him, he would go and hug him and say, I forgive you. And they did this to this man. So can you imagine the faith that he's showing those people? And a lot of people in that jail we are have come to know Jesus Christ because of his captivity experience. He's in there in jail, even though he's wrongly accused. They're locking him up because he's a Christian. But he's not in there cussing. He not saying, I'm going to call President Obama, I'm going to do that. He ain't in there doing all that kind of stuff. They told him to just renounce this, man. We'll let you go. He said, I cannot. That was his quote. He said, I can't do that. I can't do that to Jesus. In that kind of experience. That's all you got to do. Is just say, look, I don't believe in you, whatever. You know, even though God is my heart, I'm going to just say this for him so I can go home and see my kids and my wife. He could have done that years ago. He's been in there over 2 years now. Falsely in prison. But folks have come to Christ because of that. This young lady here exhibits that same kind of faith. She's been taken from her home and her family, y'all, put in somebody else's house and made a servant. She wasn't somebody that came and said, ooh, I like you, girl. Come on and be one of my congregants. Like, no, she's a servant. She got a job every day working for somebody. But her faith is so that somebody believes what she said. She could have just been talking, right? Could have just been spouting junk. But they believe what she said. They go and say, hey, look, this little maiden said, and the king, verse 5, says, and the king of Syria said, okay, go. I'm going to send a letter to the king of Israel. So even though they had Israel captive, they still left little folks in place. Say, I'm going to send this man a letter and tell him, I'm going to send him 10 pounds of silver, 6,000 pieces of gold, 10 chains of clothes. They're trying to give some gifts to get something. A lot of folks think that today. They want to do stuff their way. They know if I want something from you, I got to give you something. Tell somebody. A little quid pro quo, a little something for something. Ain't nobody just gonna do nothing for you, you know. Well, you better watch out. If you get here right away, you know he wants something. Man, don't care. That girl cook a few bands, you know. Man, watch out, brother. She's trying to get you, man. She's gonna trap you. She wants something. Because that's the way the world operates. Most people in the world, if they're giving you anything, they want something. They want something for it. There's an ulterior motive. Not so with God. I don't come and bribe him for the good things he's done for me. Right? Another song we used to sing in church says, how much do I owe? Lord, I couldn't begin to run a tag. I couldn't even Google it. I couldn't Wikipedia. Nobody can tell me how much I owe to him for what he's given to me. So I can't begin to even try to remember. I can't even put nothing down on it. Anybody else remember Layaway beside me? Back between when you were young, hello somebody, my little furthest stereo I had, I got from Kmart. And I put a little something down on it, and I went back every couple of weeks and paid on it. I ain't had no credit card, but I put something down. I can't even begin to put something down on what God has done for me. But this king, see, he had the wrong idea. He's sending all this stuff thinking, if I tell them this, they'll work this out. I'm going to send silver and gold and all this chain and clothes. So he sends all this stuff and comes to the king and says, look, this is what I want you to do, verse 6. Say, I've sent my servant Naaman, and I want you to recover him, heal him of his leprosy. And the king say, what you talking about? What you mean? The king say, what, am I God to kill and to make alive? And look, man, this man sent me somebody sick with leprosy and tell me to heal him? The king said, I don't have that kind of power. He said, man, this man must be crazy. So sometimes when folks make a demand like that of me, he said, man, this dude starts. He's trying to get a fight started. I'm going to send this man back. He said, man, I couldn't do it. And he's going to come and kill me and all my people. Because y'all remember, they kill kings. That's the first folks they would get is the royal family. They would take the best of the best and drag them away in chains. The king said, man, this dude's trying to start. So he's trying to start a fight. So the king says in verse 7, he seeketh a quarrel against me. He's trying to start some stuff. And it was so that when the prophet, verse 8, Elisha, heard it, he said, wait a minute, king, why are you tore your clothes up? What's going on? You snap your neck in front of you, rip your clothes up. What is going on here? And he says here, wherefore hast thou rent thy clothes? He said, let him come to me. Let him come on down here. He says, and I will show that they will know that there is a prophet in Israel, that God is still here amongst his people. Now, granted, remember it says that this man Naaman had already come to Israel and took some folk away. But now here he come to Israel begging for what? For help. And what does the man of God say? Man, get the out of here. Man, I ain't got no time for you. Now the man of God says what? Send him here. And he says, I'm going to do what for him? He didn't say, I'm going to bless him out in the name of Jesus. He didn't say we're going to deck him in ambush. He said, no, I'm going to help this man. You mean in spite of, this folk, maybe some of your family members they dragging away to see him. Mm-hmm. He says, I'm going to help him anyway. Hello, church today. In a world today where folks is upset about what the Supreme Court did, upset about a flag over here, upset about a dude in Tennessee who killed five Marines today. We upset about all this other kind of stuff. But if them same folks come today and say, Brother Robert, I need to know about Jesus. Man, I can't talk to you, man. You done killed. I was in the middle of church. That made me mad. Boy, if I had my gun, I'd blow you. If they were to come today, the attitude we ought to have is to give them the help they need. And that's Jesus Christ. What did we read in Luke? Jesus said, repent now, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. We can't be a church that does a tit for tat, I think, a quid pro quo. You kill some of our Christians, we're going to catch some of y'all people and kill them too. It's sad what those ISIS people are doing to Christians around the world. Over in Egypt, what did they do? In France, just a couple of weeks ago, what did they do? And in France, they made a spectacle and put the folk head out there on the fence pole so that people coming to work could see that and like, oh my goodness. Like saying, you better watch it, like a warning, what they did to these folks over there in France. But if those same people were to get it right between the Lord led them and they had a big old ISIS t-shirt on, and I'm looking like, oh, look, man, they come in here, but they really repent and they want to know about Jesus Christ, and I can't talk to them. We're going to sit down, we're going to break bread. And I'm going to attempt to share with you. You say God has sent you here, you see the attitude of the prophet. He said, no, come on, send him to me. I got something for him, and he wasn't setting him up. So Naaman came with his horses and with the chariot. Now remember, it says he was a great man, verse 1. He was honorable, so he had a little something about him. He had a name out here in this world, a little fame about him. So he figured folks ought to kind of bow down. So he comes to the prophet's house with his horses and his chariot, and he stood at the door. And Elijah didn't even come to the door. Elijah said, I ain't got to be our lady. I didn't even give you what thus said. I ain't got to be your buddy. I ain't got to come in no schmooze with you. Look, this is what the Lord said. Here you go. You're going to do that. It's not the way you want it, Naaman. See, Naaman got upset. Because we see here in the next verse, he says in verse 11, he got what? Angry. Why? Because he said, behold, I thought surely the man would come out and see me, shake my hand, say, oh, great Naaman, oh, powerful Mr. Honorable Ruler, salute him or something. He said, sir, he didn't come to the door. He said, Gehazi, somebody, y'all, go tell that man what to do. And Elisha was maybe back there praying, maybe studying the word. Ain't no telling, he was doing something. But the Lord sent someone to him. But guess what? Naaman wanted it. And the other problem we have today, anybody remember this? The little song, Frank Sinatra, I did it, my. A lot of folks want to get to the end of their life and say, guess what, I'm a self-made man, I did it my way, but Lord help, when you close your eyes and open them in death, you did it your way, guess what? If you didn't do it Christ's way, just like this road of mine, brother, where that road go, man, I couldn't tell you. And just wind off into nowhere, that's where you're going. You headed nowhere fast. Because Jesus said, I am the way, the truth and life. So as I do it his way at the end of my life, the body tells me, asking for the body, present with the Lord, where is it? Man, I don't care. Wherever he is, I'm going to be with him. But folks want to come and sing a song, I did it my way, it's all about me. Okay, you think that if you want to. It's all about you, huh? Naaman thought it was all about him. He wanted to do it his way. This is what he expected. And we all do that, don't we? We all have expectation. I mean, come on now, fellas. Hello. You come home with a little smell good, some flowers and some chocolate. Baby, I was thinking about you. I was down there. Here you go. Okay, thank you. Put them on the table. Wait a minute, huh? You know, this ain't me. Girl, you know how much these things cost? You sit them seat on the table. Okay, let me sit there and sit down. Go away. She's going to make me comfortable. You know, tell her brother, thank you. Come back and you're still sitting there. But baby, ain't you going to put these in some water, chocolate? We expect some things. We expect a certain thing to be done a certain way. And when it doesn't happen, we get what? Kind of upset. I tell y'all, we got some of the best field words right up in here. George Lucas ain't got nothing. We got some Star Wars and everything else. We got it played out how we want it to happen, and sometimes it just don't work that way. You get home and, well, she's tired. You get home and, well, it's been a rough day. He get home and, baby, let me tell you, I ain't got time, but I need to go. But this is the way I pictured it. I want it to happen. I want it to go. But that same kind of attitude, like that little kid doing like this, we do the same thing in Christian. We expect God to call, Lord, I'm here on Sunday. Ain't you going to heal my mom? God may say, no. My grace is sufficient for you. Well, Lord, you know, I need this job. I went on 4 or 5 minutes. Ain't you going to give me? God said, no, Robert, that's not the one for you. But Lord, I need, he knows what I need.
Yeah.
But because I expected and I wanted what? My way. That's why I told y'all in my opening prayer. When we pray for folks, we're going to pray with you. But ultimately, I say what? God's will be done. See, it's not about what I want. You may want to be healed. God may know by keeping you at home sick for a minute, that's going to protect you from doing something ignorant if you were to do this on the other end. God knows that. I don't. I tell you all the time I wear glasses, but I can't see past that wall. I don't know what's going on out there on 85. God does. I don't know what's happening in my home right now. God does. That's why I follow him. I know my eyes bad. That's why I wear it even worse than the fifth grade. But I can't hardly know it. But God does. So that's why I follow him. It's not about my way. But we all have that same sort of little attitude, that little spoiled kid, what I wanted and I want it now.
Right.
Naaman wanted it and he wanted it just like they said. Look, man could even come to the door and see. So it says that he wanted to do a big thing and put his hand and wave his hand up in the air and, oh God, like rain down fire, all this kind of stuff, just to heal him from leprosy. If he really had known anything, maybe, why don't you talk to that Israelite girl, go back and get you a scripture and look at what really needed to happen. You should have brought some bird. You should have brought some stuff with you if you want to be healed from leprosy. And it wasn't gold and it wasn't clothes. There's supposed to be some birds brought, some blood cut, sprinkled over. Come on now, let's get with it. If you really want to do this thing, let's do it the right way. But now you come and think you can bribe the Lord into healing you.
Yeah.
come to church today. Donate some money, give a building, donate a car, give the church a book. They think just whatever they do, they can do it their way, and that's going to get them into heaven. Well, I'm giving my services free. You know, I'm a landscaper. I'm going to go there and cut the church grass. I know the Lord will take that little bit off your books. What books you got? My God, I got some little accounting book you can go scratch. Well, Lord, I cut the grass. I shampooed the floor. I cleaned the bathroom. Okay, Ann. Don't you clean the bathrooms at your house, too? You want some credit for that? But folks think we can bribe and get things done in Christianity, what? Our way, because that's the way the world operates, right? When I go to McDonald's and say I want a Big Mac, if I give them, I don't know how much it costs, but if I give them a certain amount of money, I expect what? To get a Big Mac. I can't go up there and say, hey, Ronald, man, I slept your floor. Even as an employee, and I used to be there a long time, you had to pay for your food. Otherwise, you steal it. And all we got was half price machine. Oh, yeah, yeah. So when I got that Big Mac and fry, I had to pay for that. Yeah, it wasn't free. Ronald wasn't giving me nothing. Pay for my fries, my drink. If I want extra cheese, they charge me with extra cheese. Just like I was a customer. I did get half price, but guess what? I had to pay for that. I can't say, well, Ronald, I'm showing up. I got my uniform. Ronald said, yeah, but I bought the uniform. Oh, yeah, you right, man. The little ugly paper hats we wore back in the 80s, they didn't think. Ronald gave us them. Had to have a new one the other day. Because back on that grill, I sweated out that little ugly hat. I could throw it away at the end of the day, come back tomorrow, guess what? Paper hats cost money. Didn't think about that. All I thought about was, man, I'm working back here fixing all these Big Macs. I want one. Chicken nugget, I want one. I shouldn't have to pay because I'm working. It's hot back here. Ronald said, nah, partner. You go on break. You go on the other side of the counter. You let them address you, and you give me some money, and I give you that Big Mac. Couldn't work my way into it. But when it comes to God, we think if we just come to God and give him any kind of thing, it's going to be all right. Naaman wanted him to say, I want you to wave your hand and do this, that, and the other. Strike your hand. Call on the name of the Lord. He wanted a big old show. A lot of churches today on Sunday, big old show. And nobody's life being changed. Choir going to sing. Folks going to get happy rolling now. Y'all, Lord help. I think I showed y'all a video. The pastor gonna run and talk about God hitting the home run. He gonna run around the church, then he come slide like he's sliding in the glory. Show. Entertainment. Look good. Praise dancers, y'all. I showed y'all. But Kevin on stage had a little praise dance thing. He said, I didn't know whether to be watching the ministry. He said, I was getting excited because of the way the praise dance was dressed. He said, I shouldn't be feeling these feelings of jerk. But the little girls up there moving and whatever, and what they had on was inappropriate. He said, I couldn't even enjoy the ministry. Because he was trying to, man, what? Ooh, hello. I'm in church. All this other kind of stuff. Go on, folks want to show. Right? They want some sizzle. They want some, you got to keep my attention. I ain't got to keep nothing. I give you Jesus Christ. He's the one's going to keep you.
Yeah.
But we come, so this is what Naaman, a lot of folks like Naaman, if they had the same attitude, they want to show. Right? I'm in the hospital. I want the pastor to come. The pastor's busy. You know, his own son is sick. He's going to say, nah, I'm the pastor. Deacon can't get a prayer through? Number one, have you prayed and talked to God? Because I can pray from my home. I can get outside of my bed and pray. I can just close my eyes and say, Lord, in the name of Jesus, and he know. But you want somebody there. You want it your way. And a lot of folks, I'm a pastor, Kyle's a member. Baby, just like that. Remember standing like, look, but I want him to come and then, all right, sister, here I come. Know you tired. Or maybe have a wreck on the way there. You done worked this and done it. But you go and do all this stuff trying to tend to folks. Thank you. So name him on the show. And then he says, wait a minute, he told me to go into Jordan. Now the Jordan wasn't a clean river. Muddy,
kind of nasty.
And he said, he want me to get in there not one time, seven times. Dip myself down like dunking your daughter in some coffee. He want to go down there seven times in that nasty water. And he was going to come up clean. Hey, that's what the man said. So he thinks, wait a minute, wait a minute. I'm from Damascus in Syria, up here in our area. He said, we got the Abana River and the Farfa River. Hey, aren't those better? Can I just go dunk in one of them? He said, can I wash in them and be clean? That's not what the man of God said. Here he is questioning. And what do we do? Some of us are going to leave here this morning and question, because I'm just a vessel. Question what the word of God said. Bro, I did think, you know, God could have been nice to him and just, God said, it ain't about no being nice of what I think. Remember, God is the only true and righteous judge. God knows what's going on. God is naming his heart. So he's saying, well, can I go do this? And they better than all the waters in Israel. He said, can I just wash them and be clean? So look, he turned and went away mad. Like, if you ain't gonna get it for me, I'm a man in my family. My mom said it happened to me one time. Got into the store. Said I wanted something. She said I couldn't have it. She said I fell out one time. She walked away, never wore it again. When she walked in the store, I was just like, bitch. She said, mom, whoever wants to cook, I go, because I thought mama was gone. I looked up at Sheila back then, folks, you know, you cried, wasn't no defects. I don't know. Mama could just smooth leave, you'd be like, be out of the car, and you'd be like, wait, mama, I'm sorry. Mama left one time. That broke me up from that. If I asked her, she said no, and really. Capricorn too. I ain't even mad. Mr. One, if mama didn't have it, wasn't no Capricorn in the box. There wasn't no Capricorn this week. If mama said it was cornflake, we didn't have Tony Tiger. Mm-hmm. Tony Tiger's great. Now, we had the cornflake with the roost on it and could barely put a little bit of sugar on it, if that. Because mama had you in sugar for other stuff. Said, you want the sweet? Put a banana in there. Okay. Mm-hmm. Put a banana. But I'm saying, if that's not the way they do it on TV, ah, you better. Mm-hmm. And we just said it with mama. But we thought that. So ain't no banana in the thing on the box. It's a chicken. We wanted Tony. No. Tony cost too much. So we had to take whatever they had, post, raisin bran, whatever the regular one was. We wanted it what? We wanted it the way we want. But here he is. He said, aren't this better than them? This is what you were told to do. So he got away and what? Went away mad in a huff. And his servants came and said, wait a minute, hold up. Now, if the man had told you to do some great thing, he said, go wash over here, take two birds and throw them over your shoulder, ride the donkey down to the bottom of the camel, go see a little old man, he gonna give you a potion and drink it. You don't know what it is. You would have done all that. Because he told you just go dunk in this river 7 times, that seemed too easy, and you don't want to do it. And it caused Naaman to think. Church today, folks are going to come to us. Some folks are still going to hear the message.
Right.
They're going to come and want to see some big old this. And, well, how come y'all know? Because on TV I saw, okay, well, why don't you go to that? But I want you to do, now, why don't you go to that? Ever have somebody come to your home? And you tell folks, you know, we say this, maybe we need to stop saying it, tell them, meet this in the home. Sometimes you don't know how a person treats their home, they don't even make themselves at home at your house. They may put their feet on their furniture at their house, but Rob don't allow that in our house. Ask my kids, they'll tell their friends, you know, Ryan, your friend, amen, don't put your feet on my dad on. Folks want to come and lay on your, now you lay on the floor. You lay on the bed. I mean, we couldn't do that just the way I'm doing. Now that I'm all into the furniture, my wife has already said once the kids leave, we're going to get some more. But while we have what we have, we try to take care. I don't put my feet on the couch. I pay for it. You ain't gonna put yours up there. You come in, it's gonna go through my box and open up. No, I don't. We may need to be careful, unless we know the type of home folks come. Tell them to make themselves. That's all I do. I'm making myself at home. And our home, that's what we do. We get the milk and we drink out. No, man, nobody want all that. You gotta take that gallon with you, partner. We don't want that. But you tell them what? Make themselves at home. You may need to watch that. So he said, if he had told you to come do all this special stuff, Naaman, you would have done that. But he told you to do something simple. And you're like, now, that can't be that easy. Can I go to this river? Can I go over there? That was better. They're cleaner. Mm-hmm. So what Naaman does, thank you to God, he has some good sense about it. He says, okay, he got down, dipped himself 7, not 6, he didn't obey, 7 times, according to the saying of man of God. He didn't do it his way. He did it God's way. And it says, his flesh came again, likened to the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. So he was obedient. He didn't want to be. We can see it. We can see the whole thing play out. And it's easy for Brother Robert to stand here in 2015 and point the finger and say, that name was stupid. But guess what? I'm the name. I've done that myself. Lord, I want my marriage to be like this. Lord, I want my kids to be. Lord, I want to live. Lord, I want this kind of car. I want it my way. God said, no, Robert, you can't handle that, Father. No, you're making it forward the nose, but guess what? When it break down, then you know, we don't think about that. I can let you live over here, but then they got home. Oh, that's, you know, we wanted what? Our way. But as a child of God, I have to trust that where God leads me is where he wants me to be. I don't make mistakes, per se, not that I'm perfect, but if I follow where he leads, I'm not making a mistake because I'm following what? The say the Lord. If God says, Robert, this is what I want you to do, this is what I want you to say, this is where I want you to go, I want to do it what? His way, not mine. Now in the New Testament, Jesus picks up an example from the same story in Luke chapter 4. Now notice, remember what we said. Now Naaman wasn't a believer, as far as we know. Well, we know he was. But after this experience, I'm going to stay at Kings for just a minute. We read this already. But now in the Old Testament, or right at the end of what we read in chapter 4, verse 14, the man Naaman tries to give some gifts to the prophet. And Elisha says, I don't need that. That's a good example. I don't even talk about it. Well, that's a good example for some of us as Christians today. Everybody want to give you something. I don't need something all the time. Now, but he says here in verse 17, now listen to this. Let's look at a change of heart. He says, shall there not then, I pray thee, be given to thy servant 2 mules, bird of the earth, for thy servant will henceforth. Verse 17, right here, he says, for thy servant henceforth, from this point on, Naaman says, offer neither burnt offering nor sacrifice unto other gods, but unto the Lord. Naaman says, not only have I been changed, Naaman says, my heart has been changed. I'm not going to do this other kind of stuff to these gods no more. The only person I'm going to worship. worship is God the Father. Now, how he was going to do all that, he had to figure that out. That was on him. No, it's his decision to make. But he works with somebody else, doesn't he? Look at what he says in verse 18. Now, in this thing, he says, the Lord pardons you. Now, forgive me, Lord, but I'm going to have to do it. You ever had somebody do that in Christian? Lord, forgive me, I'm going to have to cuss him. But you already have to give him something. You know it's wrong. Lord, forgive me, I'm going to have to go. I'm going to have to get him, but I'm going to have to go there. He says, Lord, pardon us, that when my master, not me, when my master goes into the house of Ramah, that's their little thunder god, to worship there. So it's an idol god. And he leans on my hand, which is common, as the right-hand man, the king would lean on or whatever, got him right there with him, and leans on my hand. He says, I bow myself down in the house of Ramah. When I bow down myself in the house of Ramah, the Lord pardon thy servant in this thing. He said, Lord, forgive me, because I'm going to have to do it, because I'm with him. That's the decision he has made. Now, if I'm God's child, I have no business going over there and praising anything else. What did Pastor Abedini say? I cannot do it. Not that I will. I says, I can't do that. He says, I can't do that to my God. Y'all will have to kill. He says, I can't do it. I can't renounce my Savior. He's been too good to me. So notice what he says. Now listen to the man of God. He says, and he said unto him, go in peace. So he departed from him a little way. He didn't tell him, that's all right. It's okay. He told him to do what? Go in peace. Whose decision was it decided to do things God's way and his way? Shouldn't he have been doing that? Mm-hmm. But he didn't bless that. Because by blessing him, he said, well, that's all right. God understand. God know your heart. Then he would have been what? Condoning idolatry. He didn't do that. And he didn't even tell the man, you know, that's wrong. That's for you to decide. You now have said there's been a change of heart. You just told me you're just going to worship the Lord our God. But now you're talking about, oh, and I'm sorry. I'm going to have to go. You're speaking on both sides of your mouth. The world today is seeking a blessing from the church for some of the mess they're doing. You see it? It's the same attitude. They run and want this. Well, I want the church. I want you, Pastor. Man, you ain't making me do it. Like I told y'all before, say what you want to, my brother Robert. Don't put your hands on me. Say what you want to. Say, talk all the man, talk. But when it gets physical, when there are hands on me, then I got to stop that behavior. And I'm going to do all I can to deter that behavior. So talk all you want to. But folks in the world, they want the church to bless some of this mess they're bringing. That's what they're looking for. They figure, well, that'll be all right because I'm going to do. That's why they force it on through mass media, social media. All they just push. Everybody's talking about it. Put it on TV. Teach it to kids in the school. We'll make them comfortable with it. I don't think so. There again, my Savior still would be okay with some of the behavior that's happening in the world today. If Jesus isn't okay with it, I'm not okay with it. I can't do it, brother. I can't spoil my own self. Jesus, you just don't know. In 2015, the president say this, Supreme Court, they passing law. Jesus, man, you just don't understand. And Jesus did the same thing. They took him before the law officials. Law officials even said, man, ain't nothing wrong with this man. Jesus just gone. I'll let you go. Jesus said, uh-huh. I got to do what they said the law. They took him to the authorities. And they used, quote unquote, their laws. Again, they lied. But they used the legal system against our Savior and killed him, an innocent man. Done nothing. Some of them folks, maybe some of the ones he healed out there, may have had a cousin or somebody. He healed. They were out there saying, crucify him. Give us Barabbas. Give us that known thief. Give us him. And don't take that Jesus and kill him. Luke chapter 4. So we see Naaman's attitude had changed. We don't see that God didn't bless that. He's telling him, go in peace. That's the decision. In the world today, folks are going to come to the church and want to say, well, brother, I know, but it's just so hard for me to change. Mm-hmm. If you didn't give your heart to Jesus, the change is. God's way. Luke chapter 4. Then Jesus said, going back to what we just read, many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was clean, saving Naaman the Syrian. So you mean of God's own people. Notice what it says. In Israel, there were lepers. It says, and none of them were cleansed, saving Naaman the Syrian. Now, of course, we understand that God allowed them to be conquered because they're disobedient. So God may have just cut that blessing off from them for a minute. But it says, Naaman, here he was this non-believer, who did have a changed heart and was still growing because he was a baby in Christ. That's why he asked that whole thing in the first place. But just go forgive me because I got to go with my master. It's not right. Say the name of the Syrian. Look, and all they in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. Now, wait a minute. Before this, we talk about Jesus going out through Capernaum and Syria and this area, doing all these cleaning and talk about how his fame is spreading. Right? That's what we read about even here in verse number 14 in the same chapter. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and there went out a fame of him through all the region round about. Why was there a fame about Jesus? All those wonderful things he was doing. But now, all of a sudden, they upset and ready to kill him. Hello, church folks. Don't get fooled when the world starts. yourself, you get a few folks showing up, man, something good going on. And they all worldly folks, ain't no heart change. You better watch it. Because the same ones who, hallelujah, let's do it, woo, woo for Jesus. The same ones who be like, they want to take Jesus and throw him off a cliff, you know. Because he shared with them what was going on. He was sharing it with what? The first thing he said, you're going to say in verse 23, physician, heal thyself. Whatsoever we have heard done in Capernaum, that's what we read in Matthew. Do it here. Say, all that stuff you did in Capernaum, come on, Jesus. Heal some folks here. Do it here. And Jesus said, what? Verily I say unto you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. We are, for lack of a better term, we are Americans. In here, living here in America. We are Christians. We choose to follow Jesus Christ. Even in our own country, there are folks who don't have nothing to do with us. Because y'all too dogmatic. You too this. You too judgmental. We talked about that last Tuesday. But the scriptures say, judge not, lest you be now. That's not what it means. Because in the second part of the scripture, it tells us to be able to discern between what? Dogs and swine. So there is a judgment that has to be made. I'm not supposed to condemn you to hell. I don't know what ultimately is going to happen to you. Like I said, I can't see past that corner. So you may be ignorant today, but God can save your soul tomorrow. So it's not for me to condemn you to a devil's hell because of what you're doing today. If God had stopped me and some of the silly stuff I did, I wouldn't be here today. But God let my, as they say, golden moments roll on a little longer. And here I am today, standing before you. Am I perfect? No. I'm better than I used to be. And thanks be to God that he didn't call me into question then, but he knew Robert's going. He didn't condemn me on that one act. That first time I was whatever age and saying a lie, that should have been it. All it takes is one sin. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. That first time I told my mama I didn't eat that cookie when I did, that should have been it. When me and my brother, Lord help, broke mama's stomach, realized that we didn't know who did, all of us got in trouble. I said, me. All of us got in trouble. I should have been gone. But God knew that one day he was going to call me this, that somebody needed a daddy. Somebody needed a husband. Somebody's going to need a wife. So he kept me here a little while to do this, and he knew how it would turn out. He didn't condemn me to a devil's hell off of one act. That's not for us to do, but I sure can't judge, man, that behavior. Keep that up, brother. That's not good. God doesn't like that. But people want to tell you in church, you can't judge. No. Dogs and swine. We're not supposed to give our stuff here to the dog. We're not supposed to put my pearl before swine. That's what the scripture says. So guess what? I can call it what it is. I can inspect the fruit. I can see what's happening with you. But folks want to, that's what the people want to tell us in the world today. You can't judge me. You can't tell me that. You better read the scripture, bro. You better get in there and study that thing. Get you a Greek and Hebrew dictionary. Read what it really meant when they talk about that kind of judge. I'm not condemning you, but yeah, that behavior you're doing, God doesn't like that. That goes contrary to the word of God. Judge now, you just using something to try to fight me with it. You can't fight me with this. I know this. I live this. It's a part of me. So Jesus says here, no prophet is accepted in his own country. But I tell you the truth. And he goes on to speak here. He says, many lepers, we'll read in verse 27. And it says, and they in the synagogue, in the church, they got mad at him. When they heard these things, they were filled with wrath. And they rose up and thrust him out and said, get out of here, Jesus. And led him to the brow. Got him right there to the edge of a cliff, a near cliff edge, where they were going to throw him over. Said that they might cast him down headlong. They were going to throw him over the cliff head first. No. They weren't going to push him until he kind of grab it after he pull up like you see in the movies. You go back and look and see, oh, somebody hand come up and like, whoo, man, he made it now. They were going to make sure, head first, they were going to throw him off the cliff. But he passed right through. And notice, he did what? He went in the midst of them which way? It wasn't what they wanted. Their way was to do what? Let's get rid of this Jesus. I'm sick of it. But all this stuff he had done, they were tired of Jesus. He put that on, well, ain't nobody going to respect him in his home. What? You trying to say we don't? Their feelings got hurt. And what do they do? Mob mentality. Let's kill it. Rush it. All of them got there together. We're going to throw our Savior off a cliff. It wasn't his time. But it says he didn't do it his way. He didn't cuss. He didn't call. He could have Elijah, called down fire from heaven. He could have got anything. Stuff had been done and then some he could have done. Didn't do it. He simply went what? His way. He followed after the Father. He didn't do it his way. Not for you. For some of us, we would, man, you better get your hand. I won't. No, we would have started throwing some blows. But Jesus did it his way. So the question for you and I is, in knowing the times of the day, and knowing what has happened, and what Jesus even spoke, when we read about it in Matthew's gospel, that he began to preach, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Knowing that the kingdom of heaven was at hand then, we're some 2,000 years away from that. You think we're closer now? Hallelujah, somebody. You think we don't need to be preaching that same message and time after all this other kind of stuff? I want to do it my way. If my church don't look like, we need to dress like, what does that have to do with anything when it comes to the cause of Christ? But our churches, the places we're supposed to be doing this and taking the lead in this, we're giving in and following after the world system. what the world tells us to do. Somebody did a study and said, do it like this. You'll get more members if you do, man. Like I told y'all before, I ain't running for office. My name, my last name ain't Obama, Kennedy, Bush, Carter. I ain't running for office. It's not a popularity contest. When I get there, I want them to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Why, Robert? Because I did it your way. I didn't sit there like a little pirate kid, but Lord, shit, I'm looking at Jay, Creflo, and all of them. I'm telling the truth. Why come ain't nobody? How come I don't have, I want a G6, whatever. I want this, I want that. Now, Lord, I'm doing it your way. Because it's not about me. It's all about Jesus. Lord, forgive me for those times I've had that layman type spirit. Lord, you could have done something. You could have done it magic where everybody would know you blessed me. Made the sky open up and fireworks shoot out and out. Man, Robert, please, I bless you. Move on, son. Nothing to see here. Move on. You know, we want a big show. Production, a three-ring circus, fireworks, parade. You don't need to have that naming spirit, but Lord, I want to do it. Our last and final selection on this morning is that the beauty of Jesus be seen where? In me. So, Father, don't let folks see that naming spirit when I may feel like that, or see that Judas spirit, that evil, that whatever. Don't let them see that, Lord, but let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me, because remember, you may be the only Jesus some people ever see. They may never come into this church or any church. But they see you at Walmart, at the college, at the park, in your yard. Are you being that light and that salt you need to be? We don't, I ain't at church, so I can go on and do what I want. No. You got to be ready each and every day. Right? Elisha stayed in the house. He sent a servant up there, but he was where he was supposed to be. Doing what he said. He didn't fight him like he wanted to. He didn't say, man, you done took some of my people away. I ain't going to help you. God sent him, and he used him. Okay? John chapter 3, verse 30 says, what simple?
He must increase them, but I must decrease.
Amen. That's the truth.